Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Apologies have been received from Natalie Dawn, and I'm pleased to say we've got Evelyn Tweed along as Natalie's substitute. Our first item of business this morning is to take a decision on taking item three in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. Our main business today is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government on the Scottish Government's priority for government. As this is the first time that Shona Robison has appeared before the committee, I'd like to take the opportunity to congratulate her on her role and welcome her to the committee. As a former colleague on the Social Justice and Fairness Commission, it's a real pleasure for me personally to see you in the position that you are in. And we as a committee are looking forward to working with you over the coming session. I also welcome the Scottish Government officials who will support the Cabinet Secretary today, Alison Byrne, Deputy Director, Social Security Management and Delivery Division, and also Paul Tyrer, the Interim Deputy Director, Social Justice and Regeneration. And I'd like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement, please.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone on the committee. It seems strange being here, given I was on the committee previously, so nice to be back for the first time in this role. As the programme for government made clear, the Scottish Government has an ambitious schedule of work ahead on social justice and on social security. I'd like to just briefly update you on some priority areas, including driving forward our national mission to tackle child poverty and our social security programme, combating homelessness and violence against women and girls. Turning first to child poverty, in March we will publish our second Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan, setting out ambitious actions across the three drivers of poverty to deliver our interim targets backed by a further £50 million fund. We are on track to deliver the Scottish child payment to under-16s by the end of 2022, subject to UK government cooperation. We will double the payment to £20 a week as soon as we can within this session, and we will set out details of exactly when and how when we publish the budget bill. To ensure that we are immediately reaching around 148,000 young people, we are making bridging payments of £520 a year to children who receive free school meals. We have already paid out £200 of this year's total and agreed dates with COSLA for the next two £160 payments in October and December. This, of course, is in contrast to the UK Government, who in a week's time will cut universal credit by £20 a week, a loss of over £1,000 a year for 6 million households. We are determined to build a social security system based on dignity, fairness and respect. Delivery remains a joint enterprise with the DWP, and I'm grateful to them for their support and recent constructive ministerial discussions. The challenges of large-scale benefit delivery are well known. The UK Government's own universal credit was originally supposed to be fully rolled out by 2017, but is more likely to take until 2026. We are proud that in the 3 years since we've had the powers and legislative ability to deliver benefits, that we've introduced 11 benefits, 7 brand new. When all benefits are introduced and we've transferred all clients from the DWP to our Scottish systems, we'll be delivering 17 benefits, 6 more than were originally anticipated. This parliamentary term will see more milestones reached. From the 22nd of November, Child Disability Payment, our first disability benefit, rolls out nationally. And from mid-October, we'll begin to transfer awards for Scottish clients currently receiving Disability Living Allowance for Children onto Child Disability Payment. From the end of November, we'll pay Child Winter Heating Assistance for the second year, extending eligibility to severely disabled young people who receive personal independence payments. If our Carers Allowance Supplement Bill passes, we'll make a double payment of the supplement in December, totalling £462.80, and I want to thank the committee for your work on this bill. I know it was a very short time frame. Next year, we'll launch Adult Disability Payment, replacing PIP, and begin transferring around 300,000 Scottish clients onto the new benefit. Thereafter, my immediate priorities will be delivering Scottish carers assistance, where we are currently working with the DWP to agree a timetable, and, of course, our winter heating benefits. Following discussion with the DWP, we'll start with our new annual £50 winter heating payments, specifically for low-income households currently eligible for cold weather payments, in winter 2022, followed by the pension age winter heating assistance, mirroring the current winter fuel payment, which is provisionally scheduled for winter 2024. This is clearly a packed programme requiring significant amounts of legislation, and I'm grateful for the committee's support. When all these benefits are rolled out, we'll be reaching 1.8 million people, around 1 in 3 in Scotland. Social Security Scotland is preparing for that now, expecting to recruit more than 2,000 permanent employees over the next year, and by autumn of next year, we'll directly employ over 3,500 people. This is providing secure long-term employment in Dundee, Glasgow and across the country through our local delivery service, boosting economic opportunities for communities throughout Scotland, and I hope that will be welcomed by all. I just want to briefly turn to a couple of other items. I'm pleased that members of this committee have joined our cross-party steering group to take forward the minimum income guarantee, which I think is potentially revolutionary in nature. We're also actively working to tackle homelessness and rough sleeping, investing £50 million this Parliament in a new Ending Homelessness Together fund. And we're investing over £100 million to support frontline services and prevent violence against women and girls through our Equally Safe Fund and other measures. Happy to take any questions, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. I'll now invite colleagues to ask questions. And I call, first of all, Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. And I'd like to take the opportunity to congratulate the Cabinet Secretary on your post and welcome you to the committee. As you'll be aware, there's been various instances where policy has needed to be adjusted due to pressure on Social Security Scotland. Can you outline how many additional staff and resources Social Security Scotland needs to deliver the payments it has responsibility for right now, and also what the government anticipates it will need to do so once all passported benefits have been transferred from the DWP?
Can I first of all thank Pam Duncan-Glancy for her questions, and say again I look forward to working with you on many of these joint areas of responsibility and interest. I think, as I've laid out in my opening remarks, Social Security Scotland has been building up over time, but it's very clear that there needs to be a significant increase in staffing going forward, not least with the move of the disability benefits. So it is for that reason that, as I laid out in my opening remarks, we are heading towards a staffing complement of around 3,500 staff to make sure that the capacity is there to deliver the type of service that we want to deliver for clients. As I said as well, I think that's it's good for clients, but it's also good for the local economies, not just in Dundee and Glasgow, but in across Scotland, where local teams will obviously be giving a direct face-to-face service to local people. I can maybe ask Alison, actually, if you want to just say anything more about the kind of pace of build-up of the staffing complement.
Yeah, so as the Cabinet Secretary has set out there, the agency at the moment is going through the process of getting itself ready to deliver the national rollout of child disability payment in November, and then moving forward to adult disability payment next year. That's a substantial increase in staffing for the agency, and a lot of that is about the decisions the Scottish Government has taken about how the benefit will be delivered, including providing an in-house service and access to health and social care practitioners to help support client applications. So a significant recruitment for the agency over the coming year, which obviously takes time to plan and to get the right people with the right skills in post. But recruitment is on track to enable the Scottish Government to launch the significant and complex disability benefits as set out by the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you.
Yeah, happy for you to have a follow-up if you have one.
Thank you.
Pam.
Thank you very much. I do, and thank you for that. And I appreciate that it will take quite a substantial staffing resource to deliver the payments as they stand. But at the minute, that is delivering them with exactly the same eligibility and amount as the benefits are reserved. And so in the response to the ADP consultation, for example, I know the government have said that you think it's favourable to largely replicate the eligibility criteria as it currently exists in PIP. I think for the reason being around staffing resources. So do you have an idea how many extra staff you would need to start moving on eligibility and adequacy for adult disability payment? Do you believe the current criteria that PIP uses is fair? And what is your view on the 20-metre rule?
OK, so a lot of questions in there. Let me try and take them in turn. So I think it's important to recognise that the look and feel for clients will be very different. If you take the issues of functional examinations, for example, they will be removed from the consultation. Now, as you're aware, the DWP routinely carry out these tests during assessments, such as asking clients to touch their toes and so on. All of that will be removed. Assessments will be replaced with person-centred consultations, and are intended to address the concerns about how the criteria are applied, including those relating to mobility. A new way of making entitlement decisions for ADP, I think, will ensure that the criteria are more fairly applied to all clients. So I think that the engagement of local teams as well, if you take the pilot for the child disability payment, the feedback from families has been very, very positive because there's been a lot of time spent on supporting people through the system. If you translate that approach to ADP, there will be a more staff-intensive support of people both applying for the first time for ADP, but also in the case transfer across. Now, you mentioned the issue of the 20-metre rule, and I very much understand the concerns of stakeholders on this. I'm more than aware of that. I think a couple of things to bear in mind. First of all, as you've used this expression yourself in terms of the safe and secure transfer, the DWP have been very, very clear that the criteria requires to remain the same for people to be entitled to their passported benefits. Now, I just recently raised with the Minister for Disabled People the issue of policy divergence. We want to diverge policy-wise, and we've said that we'll review ADP in 2023 after the cases are transferred. The UK government has announced through its green paper that they want to review and look to make changes to disability benefits across the rest of the UK. So what I said to the minister was that, you know, given that policy divergence, we need to be able to develop and deliver policy that is suited to the needs of people with disabilities here in Scotland without being constrained by concerns of the risk of losing passported benefits. So Ben McPherson, Minister for Social Security, also wrote very explicitly asking the Minister, who has unfortunately now moved on, but asking the UK government very clearly for assurances around that passported benefits issue. Now, we've got a journey to go on that. We don't have that assurance yet, but what we do have is an agreement to discuss this on an ongoing basis. But at the moment, we need to make sure people will get their payments and that that is not put at risk. So you can understand from our point of view, even though there are frustrations, which I understand, we can't risk people not getting their payments. However, I would want to engage with the committee very fully going forward with SCOS and with Deepbag,
the
expert advisory group, who I've met recently as well, who also in their commentary recognised that, first of all, people need to have their benefits secured and no risk in terms of the delivery of that when they're transferred. But I think recognising that the review opens up opportunities for policy divergence, and I want to work with the committee on looking at what the options are going forward. Sorry, it was a bit long, but it is a very complicated issue.
That's very helpful, Cabinet Secretary. We've got further questions in this section coming from Emma Roddick and also Jeremy Balfour, and I'm hoping to come in at some stage in that part too. So, first of all, Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you, Convener. I note that the previous Cabinet Secretary raised issues with the Joint Ministerial Working Group on accessing data in order to extend the Scottish Child Payment, and I wondered if there was any update that you could provide on how that went and if those issues are still a factor.
So, again, that was an issue that we raised directly with the Minister for Disabled People last week, I think it was, that really... This is a critical issue. We need to have movement on the data from the DWP. Obviously, meantime, we've brought in the bridging payments to make sure that people, that families get the money for their kids over this year and next year. But we need to have the data in order to be able to move across to the new system. So I think it's fair to say that there is yet to be an agreement on what method that will be. The DWP have suggested one route, which we don't have full confidence in that being delivered by the DWP by our timeframes. Our officials have suggested a different way, which has not yet been accepted. However, I'm confident that officials are working very closely on this, and I would have to put on record there's a very good working relationship, particularly at official level, and I'm confident that a solution will be found. Alison is very close to these discussions. I'll maybe just let her add a little bit of detail.
Yeah, no, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So, as the Cabinet Secretary said, we continue to work very closely with DWP around how we can access the data required to deliver Scottish Child Payment Phase 2, which is for 6 to 16-year-olds. Social Security Scotland currently doesn't hold that data, so without access to information on entitlement to reserve benefits, the Scottish Government couldn't move forward and deliver that benefit. As the Cabinet Secretary said, we've established that DWP holds the data that we need. The challenge is the method within which DWP will transfer that data to us, and therefore what digital infrastructure we need to build to plug into DWP systems to get that. So, as the Cabinet Secretary said, timing remains critical for us around this, but we're working hard with DWP. We have another meeting with them today on this issue, so we are hopeful and confident that we can reach a resolution.
Thank you very much indeed, Alison. That's very helpful. For the record, we've also invited the Secretary of State to come to appear before the committee so we can discuss some of those issues around data sharing and relationship building, which is clearly going to be very important. Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Camilla, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and welcome back to committee. a couple of questions, if that's okay. Just following up a point by Pam Duncan Clancy in regard to the divergence in policy. Clearly, under the Social Security Act, we diverged in policy around terminal illness, so we have a different policy than that. Was that a problem with DWP at that point? Did they react negatively to that? Are they aware of it? And is that a way that we can build a relationship around policy difference, but it seems to be working okay at the moment?
And what was the... I didn't quite catch the...
The terminal illness, so obviously
our
definition
right.
is different. North of the border and south of the border. That's obviously a change in policy.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering how DWP and the UK government reacted to that change.
So I might bring Alison in because she would have been around when that happened. I think the difference will be, I think, around the eligibility for passporting benefits. So... and I take your point. I think there were different approaches to terminal illness, but I don't think that would have put at risk any of the passporting benefits, whereas the mobility component of PIP and then of adult disability payment, I think, is seen by the DWP as a kind of fundamental part of the eligibility for passporting benefits, so it's been treated in a different way, I think you could say. So we have to get beyond that. It appears to me an opportunity that the UK government have published their green paper that they're clearly thinking about changes. So if we're both thinking about changes, we need to come to some kind of agreement that is okay and should not put at risk the passporting on to benefits that are still currently reserved. I'm quite optimistic that I think we can get there. And if we can, then that, of course, opens up a lot of opportunities for the review of ADP from 2023. It allows us to scope and build something that, if we were starting with a blank sheet of paper, that we would choose to build rather than necessarily what we are inheriting, albeit that the look and feel, and there are some major changes being made, as I laid out in my answer to Pam Duncan-Glancy, that it's going to feel a lot different for clients. But nevertheless, we want to go further than that.
Okay, thank you. My second question is, we took evidence, I think it was either last week or the week before, in regard to take-up, and you'll be aware from your work on this committee that there are still a lot of benefits not being taken up. And one of the issues that was raised, that if we ran a campaign here in Scotland that, say, encouraged more people to apply for attendance allowance or any of the benefits like that, that there may be a financial cost to the Scottish Government, e.g. if more people take it up, mm-hmm. would that mean it has to be funded out of the Scottish Government, or would it just continue to come out of the budget from Westminster? Have you had discussions on that? And is there any clarity in your thinking around running campaigns and take-up in regard to cost?
Mm-hmm. So I remember we got into this in quite a lot of detail when I sat on the committee, and it's complex is a bit of an understatement, I would say. One of the issue, as you've quite clearly laid out, is concerns about the fiscal framework and the knock-on effects. The previous Cabinet Secretary for Social Security wrote to the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions back in February of last year to agree that an increase in take-up of reserve benefits to which an individual is already entitled is outside the scope of the spillover provisions, which you'll know a lot about, as does, and again, they are complex, and that the DWP will not seek to raise a spillover claim in this scenario. I think where one of the qualifying criteria for a Scottish benefit is that entitlement is conditional on receipt of a reserve benefit in the main income-related benefits, Social Security Scotland signposts clients to these reserve benefits, and that's particularly important in relation to take-up of Scottish Child Payment. Social Security Scotland doesn't directly promote reserve benefits as a matter of course, since I think we would regard that as being the role of the UK government. However, we do fund advice services, and they will give advice on all benefits, whether they're devolved or reserved, to try and maximise take-up and maximise people's incomes. So, I think there are ongoing issues around the fiscal framework that I think there have been a number of times it's been expressed that changes need to be made to the fiscal framework around this issue. But that's really as kind of much of an update as I can give you.
Yeah, I do. It's a very complex issue, and I'm not absolutely sure that I followed totally your answer, but that's more to do with my understanding than your answer. I do wonder, would it be possible for you to maybe write back to the committee, just put your mission a bit more of a layman's language, if that would be possible. Because I think for us going forward, if we're going to seek to promote benefits which are now devolved to the new agency, I think it would just be for me helpful to know who's going to pay for that. And I appreciate it's a very complex subject, and it's not easy to give them one answer to it, but maybe some kind of letter back to the committee, if that would be okay, committee, would be helpful.
I'm happy to do that, and maybe the exchange of correspondence that I mentioned from the previous Cabinet Secretary might help. Yeah. I'm happy to do that.
That would be very helpful. We've received some very useful and interesting evidence around benefit take-up, such as the work that was done in the deep end practices in Glasgow, for instance. So getting a handle on exactly how the fiscal framework works in that scenario would be really helpful for us, as it's an area that the committee are very interested in. First question that I've got is in two parts, please. For the Cabinet Secretary, could you please explain how challenging it's been for you, for Social Security Scotland, to be able to develop new social security benefits under the hybrid system that we're currently, part devolved system that we're currently operating under. And you've alluded to some of those challenges already. And for Ms Byrne or Mr Tyrer, please, if you could, I note that 7 of the 11 benefits currently being delivered are new. Could you outline how, you know, the differences in developing a completely new benefit are compared to, you know, maintaining a replacement benefit are in terms of infrastructure, logistics, manpower, etc., please?
Yeah. So it is complex, and bearing in mind that when Social Security Scotland was first established following the legislation back in 2018, it didn't have any infrastructure, so all of that had to be built from scratch. So from if the DWP, if the UK government decides to bring in a new benefit, it has all of the infrastructure there to be able to do that. Social Security Scotland had none of that, so essentially had to start building from scratch. And every new benefit has to essentially be built from scratch, and we've got an issue in relation to winter benefits in that regard, that if there is not a process of household matching, then Social Security Scotland has to build a new system for that one benefit. So you can imagine the complexities. On top of that, we then have case transfer. Now, this has never really been attempted, I don't think, in any way of the scale that we're going to do, where that number of cases are transferred from one government to another, one department, then one government to a department, an agency, under a different government. And the complexity of that in itself is huge, and there's no room for error there, because ultimately people need to get continuity of their payments. So all of that is very challenging. Scottish Child Payment was delivered within 18 months, and that was a very, very ambitious timescale to do it. And of course, in order to do it in that time frame, the top-up powers were used, which essentially is using the entitlement to universal credit to top up that benefit entitlement with Scottish Child Payment. Now, going forward, it would be good to have a different legislative basis for Scottish Child Payment. But again, trying to do that in the time frame wouldn't have been possible in order to get payments. So we have this hybrid system that is not ideal. Again, I said, if you were starting with a blank sheet of paper, you wouldn't build a hybrid system where you've got this interaction with the DWP that can bring its own challenges. And at the same time, you're trying to build these platforms for a system here in Scotland. Now, Alison will be able to say a little bit more about this, because she's closer to the complexities of the system. Alison, do you want to?
Yeah, no, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I think just to expand on what the Cabinet Secretary said, I think one of the challenges that we face in building a brand new public service from scratch is just that. There was no existing infrastructure in Scotland. So when DWP launches a new benefit, they've already got their payment system, they've got their document management system, they've got their telephony system, they've got everything there that they need to support the launch of a new benefit. But we've built all of that from scratch. So just to give you one example to bring this to life a little bit, when we launched the pilot for child disability payment in July, we launched that in three local authority areas. But in order just to launch that pilot in three local authority areas, we had to procure, build, develop and release 20 big bits of new functionality. They included everything from the digital portal, which is the new online way that clients can access disability benefits in Scotland, through to an appointment booking tool so that clients can go online and book an appointment with a local delivery officer, all the way through to building a document management system so that we can communicate with clients through text, through letters, and in a variety of different ways. So the complexity of those systems and the pace and scale of the processes that we're putting in place to build the infrastructure necessary to deliver benefits in Scotland is hugely complex. And to your point, convener, then, about what does that mean in a hybrid system, we then need to take those bits of kit, if you like, in Scotland and plug them back in again to DWP. So we extract ourselves to design and deliver a system for Scotland, but we need to then plug that back in again to share information. Because, of course, as the Cabinet Secretary's talked about, particularly for the disability benefits, there's a number of passport entitlements that require our systems to talk to DWP systems to ensure that clients continue to get the benefits that they currently receive. And then added into the mix of that is case transfer, which the Cabinet Secretary's referred to, which is a considerable and significant undertaking for both governments, so transferring about 700,000 cases of existing Scottish clients from DWP systems to Scottish systems and all of the associated case records and documentation that goes with that. So the hybrid nature of the system lends an additional layer of complexity to what is already quite a challenging build in terms of building a brand new public service from scratch.
Thank you very much indeed. That's very helpful and useful. My next question in this area is about any Scottish Government analysis that's taken place about the what I would euphemistically describe as UK welfare reform that's happened over the last decade. Has the Scottish Government done an impact analysis of that? And how has that impacted on the Scottish Government's ability to be able to deliver on your devolved areas of priority in social security?
Well, I think there's not just the Scottish Government's in that analysis, but there have been numerous organisations that have done various bits of analysis of the impact of the welfare reform. A lot of attention at the moment, obviously, on the reduction of the universal credit £20 uplift, which I think is estimated to potentially remove £460 million from Scottish beneficiaries. Now, I think we're fast approaching the D-Day on that, and as I've said, I think in the debate last week, I sincerely hope that there is a change of heart on that, because, I mean, apart from anything else, apart from the fact that we're in a bit of a perfect storm at the moment with rising fuel costs, rising food costs, it would just be the worst time to compound those financial pressures on households by the removal of that universal credit uplift. And I think that will put some families who are just about keeping their head above water, I think that will really be a very, very challenging situation that will make this a very, very difficult winter indeed. So huge impact. Alongside that, we've raised concerns over the piece around the benefit cap, the two-child limit, all of these things, which, again, I think just put pressure on families that are already struggling. And I think it's worth bearing in mind as well that the universal credit recipients, many of whom are already working. So the idea that, I think one of the UK government's responses has been that people should go out and get additional hours, I think fails to recognise, as this committee knows very well from the previous work it did around how many people are in work poverty, how many of those who are on universal credit are already working, but they're working in insecure, low-paid jobs. So this is huge. This is huge, and as I say, it will add to what is already a perfect storm that is brewing. Also, it undermines the work that we are doing, not least around the Scottish Child Payment. So here we are trying to get that money into people's hands, and of course the commitment to double, which is obviously a commitment shared around this table. will be giving with one hand and taking away with the other. And again, that does not help us to get towards our interim child poverty targets, which is a huge concern to me. So I hope I've given you a flavour of the work we can write to the committee with, you know, the further analysis that has been done. There's a lot of detail there. The committee members will be well aware of the kind of headline figures, but if it would be helpful for us to furnish the committee with more detailed evidence on that, we can do so.
That would be most helpful, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you very much. Sticking to the poverty theme and the child poverty targets, I'd now like to bring in Emma Roddick and Marie McNair, please.
Thank you. Yes, I like the comment from yourself, which recognises joined-up work across the portfolio is needed in order to improve people's lives, but obviously poverty and child poverty is affected by every government portfolio. So I wondered how you're working with other cabinet secretaries to ensure that their decision making is poverty aware and their policies are poverty proof.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a very, very important question, because tackling child poverty can't just be my portfolio's responsibility. It has to be the whole of government, and indeed it's the responsibility of the UK government and local government, the third sector. We need to work together around tackling child poverty, which is why I made the comments in my previous answer that it doesn't help if another organisation is facing in a different direction. So just yesterday, I gave a presentation to a public services reform group, which is a group that brings together all kind of cabinet secretaries and ministers under the chair of the Deputy First Minister to look at how do we make the improvements that we need to make to public services and do things differently. And on child poverty, I was basically making a number of asks that we have a shared responsibility, and of course everybody accepts and acknowledges that, but that we need game-changing policy ideas from across government to add to what is described as a game changer by many organisations in the Scottish Child Payment. But it's fair to say that in tackling child poverty, you need to do that in three ways. One is to make sure people have opportunities to get into work, that is secure work at least living wage, and employability programmes are an important part of that. But secondly, we reduce costs, and therefore the wraparound childcare, making sure housing costs, which are lower here than the rest of the UK, are important as well. And the third is social security and other supports. So we need those other bits. So one of the areas that's very important is around employability. And we're looking at how we can make that work for people better. So we know that, I think it's around 90% of children living in poverty live within the six priority families. Now, the six priority families are key. So they're facing issues not just around financial poverty, but disability, lone parents, BAME communities, all of those additional issues. So we need to make sure that support, it's not just about saying there's a door over there if you can find it to walk through and get on this employability programme. That doesn't work for folk who have got all those pressures upon them. So we need to wrap around the families and give them all the support. So it won't just be about a job opportunity or training. It's about childcare. It's about transport costs. It's about relieving some of the barriers and pressures. If we can get that right, I think that could get us a significant way to meeting those targets, even against that really difficult backdrop that we described earlier on. So that's one of the really main areas of focus. There'll be other things that cabinet secretaries and ministers will bring to the table, but for me, there is a big opportunity there if we can get it right. Again, I'm happy to keep the committee furnished with updates as we go forward with this, the detail of that.
Great, thank you.
Thanks, Ms Roddick. Mary McNair, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and thanks for taking the time to come along and give evidence this morning at the committee. I'm just going back to Emma's comment on poverty proofing. You're aware that we took evidence last week from the Poverty and Equality Commission, the Child Poverty Action Group and the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, and they suggested there's little evidence to show that the Scottish Government poverty proof all policies and budgets. Do you think that's a fair comment?
I think we can get better at it. I think there's more work to do. I think we do try to do that as much as we can, but I think we need to do that. We need to make sure that we interrogate all of our spend. So again, one of the commitments that was agreed yesterday is that we really interrogate our commitments in terms of spending review and the budget that is coming in terms of what impact will that spend have on tackling child poverty. Now, I think doing that is going to be a really, really important part of then getting to the right solutions. That might mean some difficult choices. Setting budgets and spending review usually does, but I think I'm keen for us to keep a kind of laser focus on in difficult times. Difficult decisions need to be made. You can't do everything. For me, this has got to be the overriding priority of government, and I think there's an acceptance of that. It's then about making that happen. So I guess it probably is fairish comment that we can. There's always room for improvement, and we can get better at it. And I want to push that.
Thank you. My experience from being a local councillor is that people often struggle to navigate the social security system and unfortunately don't have access to the full entitlements. How important do you view the role of the advice sector and how you plan to support them, especially in respect to the Scottish Government's obligation on promoting social security entitlements?
Yeah, well, I think it's an important obligation, first of all, that we should, you know, have a duty to promote benefit entitlement uptake, and it would be nice if the UK Government did the same. That would help. Advice services are really important, and they deliver huge gains for individuals, but also for families and communities, because that money that people then get will be spent quite often more so in local communities. So the value of that is huge. So you know, we see that as being key to making sure people get access to what they're entitled to and are able then to support their families. We want to do more of that, so obviously be aware of some of the work being done around co-locating advice services in places that people go to, so GP surgeries, looking at the role of schools and other places where people go, so that it's made easier for them to, and maybe like less threatening that they're in that place anyway. They don't have to walk into somewhere else. It's there. And I think the more we can do that, and I know that those working on the front line, and whether it's in the health service or in other services, really value being able to signpost someone who might be there for a health reason but are expressing concerns about the impact of debt and financial worries on their mental health, to be able then to signpost to an advice worker is really important. So we need to be. There's scope to do more of it.
Thank you. And finally, how confident are the Scottish Government that child poverty targets will be met?
Well, I am certainly doing everything I can, as is the Government, to do absolutely everything it can and to leave no stone unturned. We will give it absolutely our best shot. And if we manage to do all of that, I think we will have played our part in getting towards the targets. What I can't control, though, is the impact on those targets from decisions made elsewhere. So how frustrating would it be if the analysis at the end of the day is that we would reach the targets had it not been for people losing £20 a week off of their universal credit, for example. So there is a bit of a kind of water. You can only control what you can control. We can only do what we can do alongside third sector, local government, working and really doing everything we can. And I absolutely give the commitment to do that. So I'm confident that we will do everything we can. But you know, there are some things that are out with our control. I do have a worry at the moment around the what I described earlier as a perfect storm. I mean, the worry of fuel poverty rates going up this winter because of the rise in energy bills is something that is fast upon us. I attended a resilience meeting of Scottish Government last night that was looking at these very issues. Now, obviously, again, a lot of these issues are reserved in terms of energy caps, and we would want the UK government to do everything it can around energy prices. The big energy companies, I think, have a role to play here as well. We need to keep people safe over winter. And of course, as ever, the Scottish Government will be, you know, will step up to do what we can, and you know, you would expect nothing less. But it is a worry for people's household incomes that we have all of these pressures brewing at the same time.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Before we move on to the next section, led by Evelyn Tweed, I'd like to bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy here, please.
Thank you, Convener, for the opportunity. And you're right to point out the kind of perfect storm that people are facing, and I genuinely am terrified for what families are going to do, particularly around the cut to universal credit and fuel poverty. And it's a shame, really, that because we could have possibly had an opportunity to have a publicly owned energy firm which could have addressed some of that. But my specific question around poverty is for two of the groups you identified around children and disabled people. First of all, on the child payment, the Scottish child payment, it's last week we heard evidence saying that Social Security really is going to have to do the heavy lifting if we're to meet the targets. I understand the £20 cut to universal credit is catastrophic and should not go ahead, but the targets were set by this Parliament without caveat, and so we need to find ways across everything that we're doing in this Parliament to meet those targets. So can you commit now to do that, to do all that you can, regardless of what is happening elsewhere? We have to meet those targets. And so our view, obviously, is that we'll need to double the Scottish Child Payment immediately and again next year. So if you could set out what you intend to do to meet those targets. And then, secondly, on disabled people, have you made an assessment of the extra costs of living as a disabled person, so that we can begin to try and address some of the poverty disabled people face too?
So, look, let me be absolutely clear. Yes is the answer to your first question. You know, without hesitation, you know, we will do absolutely everything we can to meet those targets. And you're right, there was no caveats, but I think it is fair for me to point out where progress is undermined by decisions made elsewhere, and it makes that task all the more difficult. So, you know, we absolutely need to do that. Now, you described Social Security needing to do the heavy lifting, and to a degree that is true, but as the Joseph Rowntree Foundation said, it is not sustainable to try to meet the child poverty targets through Social Security alone. You just it would be unsustainable financially, and also doesn't recognise the other two pillars of reducing costs and employment, and those two are hugely important, which is why I spent a little bit of time earlier on talking about the importance of game-changing interventions around employability and making it easier for parents particularly to be able to get to where they want to in their lives, and employment and employment opportunities is a huge part of that. Now, we have said that we want to make progress on doubling the Scottish Child Payment as quickly as we can, and we've set that in the context of the forthcoming budget bill. So I'm confident that we will make progress as quickly as is humanly possible to do, and that will make a difference. But it sits alongside all the other interventions that are happening to support families. And importantly, the bridging payments have been a way of getting money into the hands of families now, without having to wait for the DWP data issues to be resolved. So that was a way of recognising that the issue is current, it's here, people need the money, and the bridging payments were a way of getting that support into people's hands. But that sits alongside Best Start and making sure that we help families with the costs of food. The work that's been going on around free school meals and holiday meals, all of which are support in cash and in kind for families to keep them afloat. And if there is more that we can do over the course of this winter, then you can be assured we're looking at that at the moment, because we want to do everything we possibly can to keep families safe during this winter.
Thank you.
And in terms of the disability assessment, the assessment of additional costs and disabilities?
Oh, my apologies. Yes, there has been work done around the additional costs, not just by Scottish Government, by a lot of external agencies as well. Happy to write to the committee with more information on that, if that would be helpful.
Lovely. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Moving on now to Evelyn Tweed, please.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I am very interested in a minimum income guarantee, and I think the public is too. Can you give us your thoughts on how challenging it's going to be to put it in place?
Yeah, well first of all, I thank you to all the parties represented who have agreed to take part in the minimum income guarantee work as a kind of political overview, if you like, and oversight, which I think is important in itself, because it's quite an ambitious thing to try and do. And having as much political consensus as possible about the principle of trying to do this and to create a minimum income below which no one would fall is a different way of thinking about the support that people get. And of course that brings into it not just the cash that people get through, whether it's through work or whether it's through supports like social security payments. It also brings in the support in kind that people would get through wraparound childcare or support with transport costs. And so on. So work has begun, and the expert group is going to be doing the heavy lifting on the detail of how this could work in practice. We think we can make more progress with a minimum income guarantee than would be possible with universal basic income, because although a minimum income guarantee does run up against the tax and benefits system, to do it fully, I think, gives us some latitude to be able to make some progress and test some of the thinking out about how a minimum income guarantee might work in Scotland without necessarily having full control over the tax and benefits system, which we don't have at the moment. So I'm keen for us to get on with the work. I think what I would like to see is that some of the ideas that emerge from the expert group that we could get political agreement around, and then we could try and test those out. So exciting, but not easy to do, and it won't be done like a week on Tuesday. It's going to take some time. But again, just want to thank colleagues for their political support in doing this.
I'm really pleased to hear that there's the cross-party input, and we're all working together to hopefully see a good conclusion of this work. But do you think that we will be able to implement something by the end of Session 6?
I think we'll be able to implement something, whether it's a fully fledged minimum income guarantee with all singing, all dancing. I'm not sure about that. We'll be guided by the expert group, but I think we'll be able to certainly implement elements of it. And it might be that we do bits at a time. So if the expert group recommend that there is a change that could get us on a stepping stone towards a full minimum income guarantee, then that would be something we could do perhaps as a series of parts of implementation. So we will certainly, my ambition, if we could, it would be good, and yes, if it's possible, we would do that. If it's not possible to do a full minimum income guarantee, then we would want to do stepping stones towards that, and we'll be guided by the expertise of those who are sitting on the group. I don't know, Paul, do you want to say anything more about the work of the group?
Well, just to say thanks, Cab 6. Just to say that the original idea for a minimum income guarantee came from the Social Renewal Advisory Board report, which was published in January. And they very much saw a minimum income guarantee as a very ambitious call to action. So it was the first call to action in their report. But they also saw it as a long-term ambition. So they recognised the complexity of it, the difficulty of getting to that game-changing minimum income guarantee. So they talked about it as a 10-year ambition, so delivery in 2030 as being realistic. So the Cabinet Secretary has talked about the potential for stepping stones towards that, but certainly the report itself recognised the challenge of that.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Tyra. Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Just to ask, what engagements have you had, your officials had with the DWP regarding MIG?
Well, over the piece, I think there's been a lot of engagement around, well, first of all, there was on the Universal Basic Income, there was a lot of dialogue or a lot of requests from Scottish Government, certainly to UK Government, around being able to test out the theory. I think, how could I describe the response as being lukewarm would perhaps be generous. So we have a bit of an issue there, that there's not a joint commitment, or there's not a joint agreement to work towards that. So that's a bit of a problem. So a minimum income guarantee, we've raised it with the UK government. I think they are perhaps not in particularly any less lukewarm, but we'll continue to discuss the opportunities. Clearly, if you had an integrated tax and benefit system, then the scope to do a lot of the more ambitious changes are easier. But as Paul said, the Social Renewal Advisory Board has set us a task. It's a very ambitious series of recommendations, and it would be remiss of us not to try and do what we can do, even within devolved powers, to make progress towards that. So whether we get any support or help from the UK government, I'm not going to put much store in that. I think we just need to get on and do what we can ourselves.
So how feasible do you think it will be without full devolution of welfare and obviously employment law to Scotland?
So having half the tools in your box is never as good as having a full toolbox, that's for sure. And we would want to continue to argue that having the full control over benefits here makes more sense. We talked earlier on about the challenges of a hybrid system and the complexities of the interaction of those two systems. That is going to continue to be a challenge, without a doubt. And that's before we get into the policy divergence issues, which again are also a challenge. The employment is an issue that I think there's more of a growing consensus that, you know, having employment powers here makes a lot of sense. I know a lot of the trade unions are in favour of it, and there's a bit more political consensus around it. And it would give us the opportunity to make some of the changes around, you know, the statutory basis for the living wage, for example, for one, issues around terms and conditions. It makes sense for that to be devolved here, and then this Parliament can make the policy choices that it wants to make. And I'm optimistic that will eventually happen, I hope.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms McNair and Cabinet Secretary. Moving on now to Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning to the panel as well. I wanted to ask some questions relating to homelessness, and specifically looking at the September 2017 Scottish Government announcement of additional £50 million over 5 years to tackle homelessness and rough sleeping. It's not exactly clear whether or not in the latest programme for government a reference to £50 million, the Ending Homelessness Together Fund, is additional money or not. So I wondered if you could clarify that to the committee.
Paul, can you help me out in terms of whether it's additional money? I think we might have to come back to you on that. I think it is, but I want to confirm that with you, if that's OK.
That would be really helpful, along with, if it is, how much money is still within the 2017 fund to be allocated, which I think would be still running 2 years.
Let me come back on the detail of that, if you don't mind.
That'd be very helpful, thank you. Also an issue which I wanted to raise was with regards to implementation of unsuitable accommodation orders. This is something which has impacted on many families who, during the pandemic especially, have maybe been left in B&Bs and hotels. Yeah. I wondered if you could outline to the committee when the government would fully implement those orders to end people in unsuitable accommodation.
Yeah. So the member, Miles Briggs, will be aware that obviously there were exceptions, particularly during the pandemic, because of the increased use of temporary accommodation, keeping people safe in hotels. Nobody wants unsuitable temporary accommodation to be used. So we have given local authorities until the end of September to essentially make sure that they are not using unsuitable temporary accommodation. And officials have been working very closely with those local authorities that have told us that they have the biggest challenge in meeting that deadline. It won't be of a surprise to Miles Briggs around which local authorities those are. Edinburgh is one. And I would have to say that despite the challenges, and I've had some very constructive conversations with the housing convener, Kate Campbell, that they have actually taken some quite innovative approaches to try and make sure that they think, use every lever at their disposal to try and make sure that they increase the accommodation supply and work towards not using unsuitable temporary accommodation. But they have flagged with us that it will be challenging for them to meet that end of September deadline. There are other local authorities that are similarly in that situation. The vast majority are confident that they will meet that deadline. So we are therefore working particularly closely with I'm just trying to remember off the top of my head how many there were, but there was a handful of local authorities that were going to find it difficult. We want to give them particular support in meeting their responsibilities beyond the end of September.
That's helpful, thank you. And it would be helpful, I think, for the committee if you could keep us updated on any of that
happy to do so. Yep.
I know from discussions I've had with the Cabinet Secretary, organisations like Crisis and Shelter have very much put forward a preventative model, which I know the Cabinet Secretary and the Government's looking at, to look at how we strengthen homelessness prevention legislation. So I wondered if you could outline to the committee timescales for that and when we're likely to see some of this brought forward in action, given the impact of the pandemic, but the opportunities potentially coming out to look at a preventative model.
So the homelessness prevention duty, again, I'll get back to the committee on the time frame, but we're hoping to do that relatively soon. I think prevention is absolutely key. There's some really good work around the rapid rehousing plans that local authorities are taking forward. They are quite ambitious. There's been a real kind of sea change of move away from the kind of systems that we had previously to a recognition that a kind of housing first approach is really important in for those that have additional vulnerabilities. So you know, preventing homelessness and local authorities and RSLs essentially working with tenants who are at risk of becoming homeless. It is not in a landlord's interest for a tenant to lose their tenancy and just end up back in the system. So a lot of work has gone on, particularly local authorities and RSLs, around that preventative work. And the pandemic has been tough, and we have worked, as you'll be well aware, on a number of ways of strengthening that. So you know, the pre-action protocols, the loan fund, the grant fund, you know, to try and make sure that people do not lose their tenancy, and that we get tenancies sustainable, and that's the best way of preventing homelessness. For those who have particular challenges, addiction issues, and other challenges, mental health challenges, then you know, the rapid rehousing and housing first model is definitely the way, because it gets people back into a sustainable tenancy, but with the wraparound support that they need.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you. Miles Briggs actually covered my question on the unsuitable accommodation order, so I welcome the response and the further updates that are to come. As someone who's been homeless, I do welcome that this is under the social justice remit rather than housing. Do you think that that's reflective of the government's good understanding of the drivers of homelessness beyond just housing availability?
Yeah, I mean, it's not just about bricks and mortar, is it? It's about all of the other supports that someone needs. And I think it's a recognition that housing itself is an important anti-poverty measure, in that it gives a safe, sustainable kind of routes to then be able to give the supports that the person, the family need. So whether that's support around dealing with addictions or mental health or debt or, you know, employability, having that safe, you know, sustainable tenancy is so important in being able to then be dealing with all of the other issues that is in someone's life. So very much so. And I think the ambitions for the affordable housing supply is, yes, it's a big number, 110,000, but it's not just about building or acquiring new houses. It's about making sure that people are supported in those tenancies successfully.
I'm aware that the Highland Council is quite worried about changes to the rapid rehousing policy, and that previously somebody had to have a connection to the area in order to have a right to be housed. And I wondered what conversations you're having with councils such as the Highland Council to make sure that they're supported to enact what they see as quite a challenging pressure that's coming towards them.
Yeah, I mean, as you would expect, these issues have been raised with us by individual local authorities and by COSLA as well. And, you know, again, it's about supporting those local authorities who have some concerns. It's the right thing to do, I think, in terms of making those changes. But we do understand that some local authorities will have some concerns more than others, and it's about us working with them to overcome those challenges.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Roddick. And Cabinet Secretary, I've got Marie McNair with a brief supplementary, please.
Sure. Just to ask yourself to advise the committee, has there been any assessment of the pressures the UK welfare cuts are having on the drivers of homelessness? Sorry.
Well, I thought it was quite revealing that there was a UK government advisor in a quote that they gave, which I think I might have used in my speech last week, said that you know, the UC cut itself would drive up homelessness, and you can see why. I mean, if a tenancy is just sustainable in terms of that, and the person loses £20 a week, that can knock what was a sustainable tenancy into an unsustainable tenancy, for all the reasons that we understand. So I think it could and will have a knock-on effect on homelessness, which is why it's absolutely wrong-headed. And again, at this late stage, we just hope that sense prevails, and that, given all the other pressures, that the UK government thinks again.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Next to come in is Pam Duncan-Glancy again, please.
Thank you, Convener. One of the issues that the Cabinet Secretary will be aware of has been ongoing for some time now, is that thousands of disabled people across Scotland are unable to access homes, and effectively they themselves are now considered homeless. We know of a circumstance, for example, in the Glasgow region, where the council is building accessible houses on a very, very small scale, and mm-hmm. only to about 8%. The government current target is 10%, mm-hmm. but it's not in legislation. Given that there's a huge variability across the country on those builds, and the significant need for accessible housing for disabled people, will the government consider making that a statutory target?
I'm always open to consideration of these things. Let me say a couple of things. I think Housing to 2040 sets out very much around the need for barrier-free housing, that as we go forward, we need to make sure that, rather than trying to retrofit homes, that all homes are built in a way that is barrier-free, and that is absolutely right and proper. And I think as we take forward the housing standard, which we want to apply across all tenures, I think there are opportunities in all of this to make the improvements that we need to make. We'll be consulting on the rental sector strategy, of which then will follow a housing bill. There may be opportunities to make some of the improvements around some of these things. If we set it in statute, we then need to be confident that that can be delivered. So there will be need to be a lot of work, but something I'd say today is that something I will give further consideration to, and I'm also happy to have a follow-up discussion with you around the cases that you're citing, and also just how that might work in practice. So,
thank you.
Lovely, thank you. Before I bring in Jeremy and Faisal in the next section, and I'm conscious of time, I don't know if you've got 5 or 10 minutes beyond 11 o'clock, Cabinet Secretary, thank you. Attention's rightly been given recently on the treatment of refugees and asylum seekers.
Yeah.
Could you expand on the Scottish Government's work on doing what can be done to provide those with no recourse to public funds access to support, and what work is going on within the Scottish Government, but also in terms of working with the UK Government in terms of trying to address this situation, which is obviously very, very challenging for those involved?
Yeah, well, it very much is very challenging, and obviously we have made it very clear that we want to play our part in the Afghanistan resettlement programme. Myself and Angus Robertson have been involved in a number of calls with UK ministers around Scotland, you know, playing its part, stepping up to the plate and doing what we can in helping people who are fleeing an intolerable situation. So obviously we've taken an approach that is captured in Ending Destitution Together, which was published back in March, and it's a joint document between ourselves and COSLA, and it really looks at how to improve and strengthen support provision and service for people subject to no recourse to public funds living in Scotland. It's really informed by really powerful testimony, and I've heard that myself because I've met virtually with a number of asylum seekers and refugees and heard directly some of the challenges that they have. Third sector organisations providing the frontline support are absolutely critical, as are the expertise of legal practitioners and others in terms of supporting and helping people deal with trauma, for example. So the strategy sets out the initial actions to deliver essential needs, enabling access to specialist advice and advocacy. And we will continue, obviously, in answer to the other bit of your question, to press the UK government to make changes to reduce the risk of people falling into destitution as a result of their immigration status. Because there are very, very strict rules about, you know, it can literally jeopardise somebody's, someone remaining here if they were had access to public funds that are regarded as not being acceptable or not or breaching the rules. So, you know, there needs to be caution there. We have also specifically asked for the UK government to remove the Scottish Welfare Fund from the list of restricted public funds, because it would be a flexible way of helping people through who are in crisis. We have not yet got agreement on that, unfortunately, but we will continue to pursue that.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That's very interesting and something I know the committee colleagues will be interested in too, and if you could furnish us with an continued update on those areas,
yep.
That would be very helpful, particularly if the Secretary of State does come before us in future. Thank you very much. Turn now to Jeremy Balfour, followed by Faisal Chaudhry, please.
Thank you, Camilla. You have a very large remit within your portfolio, to say the least. And one of the things which I was interested to note was you're responsible for OSCO and for charities. And it's perhaps not the most sexy subject ever to discuss, but I have had a number of people contact me over the years to say, is there any thought of reform for OSCO? In that, if I am a charity with two people, I almost fill out the same number of forms every year as the National Trust or a very large charity. And I know OSCO themselves, TUCA, had a consultation running earlier this year, which is now concluded. And I just wondered, is there any thinking of bringing forward reform to charity law, which may not sound exciting, but actually for many people would make it a lot easier to actually engage in the local community?
First of all, thanks for Jeremy Balfour's recognition of my rather large remit, but one that creates opportunities to join the dots across that. This portfolio. There will be a charities bill coming forward in this session of Parliament, and there is an opportunity, I think, to look at some of the issues that charities have raised and that Oscar are keen to see some changes made in the light of experience. So, again, happy to write to the committee with a bit more detail on that, if that would be helpful. Yep.
I'd be grateful. My final question, I think one of the, if anything, was positive out of the last 18 months was the relationship between local government, Scottish Government and the third sector,
mm-hmm.
particularly around homelessness. I know here in Edinburgh, for example, there was a very positive three-tier approach to it that really did work. One of the things that the third sector talk about a lot is pre-funding the funding. So often it's a one-year amount of money they get. And I know that when I was working in a third sector organisation, we used to get our redundancy notice every December, depending on whether we got money coming in the next year, which was never the most ideal place for any organisation. And I know it is difficult to forecast funding, but is there any thought that you're doing with your colleagues, particularly Kate Forbes, around a 2 to 3 year funding package for the third sector so that they could plan better going forward?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it is something that's constantly under discussion, and I have a lot of sympathy for desire for multi-year funding so that organisations know what the lie of the land is going to be beyond 1 year. And Kate Forbes has said in relation to local government as well that that would be a desire moving forward. I think that's only possible, though, if the Scottish Government has certainty too. So, obviously, if the Scottish Government gets a kind of one-year funding settlement from the UK Government, then it's very difficult to go beyond that in terms of the organisations that the Scottish Government would then fund. So, I think it depends on the certainty that we would have. I was able to give a 5-year indication of the funds available for the affordable housing supply, but I was only able to do that because essentially within government there is a commitment that we will meet the affordable housing targets, and therefore whatever funding we get, that is a key priority going forward. So I was able to do that, but in a kind of larger scale, it is more difficult. But I guess in short answer, yes, those discussions are ongoing, and we know it would be better for the third sector to have that certainty, and we'll continue to discuss the opportunities to work towards that.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour and Cabinet Secretary. Finally, Faisal Chowdhury, please.
Thank you, Convener. Congratulations on your new role. My question is on third sector. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that Scotland voluntary organisations and social enterprise are integral to Scotland economic and social fabrics? And if so, should they have had representation on the Scottish Government's Council for economic recognition and meaningful role in producing Scotland economic strategy?
So I've heard their concerns about the Council of Economic Advisers, and I understand where they're coming from on that. I think I have had a number of meetings with third sector organisations and social enterprises where we've talked a lot about their role in the COVID recovery phase, and not least their economic role. And I think social enterprises particularly are keen to play an increasing role. So there's obviously the new plan for social enterprises that recognises that they have a particular role to play, and some of them are keen to do more in areas that they've maybe not traditionally been involved in. So, for example, in housing, social enterprise sector, in a conference I had with them, were keen to look at whether they could become involved in as part of the affordable housing, social housing supply, which is not traditionally an area that they've been involved in. So I think that could be potentially quite an exciting development, and we were agreed to do some more work around that. So yeah, absolutely. And I think it's true to say that the sort of can-do mentality that we had during the pandemic, it's important we grasp and continue with that the third sector and really stepped up to the plate and helped keep people safe. They helped build community resilience, and we want that to grow. We want them to be equal partners. So we've got a bit of work to do to make that a reality. I know that. But I certainly, for my portfolio interests, want to try and make sure that the third sector and social enterprise as a part of that are really at the heart of what we're doing.
Thank you, Secretary.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I mean, just as an extension from that, I mean, one of the clear positives from the pandemic was the engagement of the third sector, but also the volunteering work that was done during the pandemic, and there appears to be anecdotal evidence that volunteering levels spiked quite considerably during the pandemic, partly perhaps more time for people that were on furlough and other reasons around community engagement. What can we do to support the likes of SCVO and other organisations to make sure we harness that greater engagement and volunteering work during the pandemic and make sure that we can take advantage of that in the future?
Yeah, I mean, that's a really important point. There was almost a kind of whole new set of volunteers appeared, people who had never volunteered before, but they wanted to help look after their neighbours. So a lot of it was very informal. But nevertheless, it tapped into something very special and very precious. I think one of the challenges going forward is that the voluntary sector will tell you that they have had a bit of a fall off from their traditional volunteers, because a lot of the, so if you were, if someone was volunteering in a charity shop, for example, obviously they were closed for a prolonged period of time, and that people were kind of got out of the habit of going and doing that, and maybe found other opportunities, and a lot of them are struggling. I was speaking to some of my local charity shops last week, and they were struggling to get volunteers. So I think we need to send out a message and play our part in trying to encourage people back to volunteering, including some of the more traditional kind of settings, so that we can make sure that they're supported going forward. So it's a bit of a double-edged sword, I think. So I think we've got work to do to make sure that we keep the voluntary sector and all of the services that they provide going forward.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. You've been very generous with your time this morning. Very grateful. We've covered a lot of ground. Mr Balfour expressed the wide remit that you have that is shared by this committee. We managed to cover a lot of that ground today, so it's very appreciated. And we look forward to the follow-up correspondence from yourself and some of the questions that were raised, and also to working with you on the shared priorities around delivering on the programme for government. So thank you very much indeed. We'll now move into private session.